because the church goes beyond the preacher. The church goes beyond the choir. The church goes beyond the position. The church is all about Jesus Christ.
Well, my brothers and sisters, again, it's so good to join all of you. I am delighted that we are back with this word on Wednesday. There's a word I'd like to share with you, and it's found, let me pull it up, the book of 1 Kings chapter 17. The last time we had our Bible study, Minister Lisa Upshaw shared with us from the widow of Zarephath, the widow of Zarephath. I want to return to that scripture that sort of explains or plays out a dynamic between the prophet Elijah and the widow from Zarephath. So whenever you get a chance, I want to encourage you to read the entire 17th chapter of the book of 1 Kings. But tonight, I just want to read a couple of passages of scripture from it. 1 Kings chapter 17, beginning at verse number 8. Let's start there. It reads this way from the New Living Translation. Then the Lord said to Elijah, go and live in the village of Zarephath near the city of Sidon. I have instructed a widow there to feed you. And so he went to Zarephath. And as he arrived at the gates of the village, he saw a widow gathering sticks, and he asked her, would you please bring me a little water in a cup? As she was going to get it, he called to her, bring me a bite of bread too. Verse number 12, but she said, this is what she said in verse 12, I swear by the Lord your God that I don't have a single piece of bread in the house, and I have only a handful of flour left in the jar and a little cooking oil in the bottom of the jug. I was just gathering a few sticks to cook this last meal, and then my son and I will die. That's what she said to the prophet Elijah, verse 13. But Elijah said to her, don't be afraid. Go ahead and do just what you said, but make a little bread for me first, and then use what's left over to prepare a meal for yourself and your son. But this is what the Lord, the God of Israel, says. There will always be flour and olive oil in your containers until the time when the Lord sends rain and the crops will grow again. Verse 15, so she did as Elijah said, and she and Elijah and her family continued to eat for many days. Verse 16, there was always enough flour and olive oil left in the containers, just as the Lord had promised through Elijah. Amen. Just as the word, as the Lord had promised through Elijah. This evening, just for a quick moment, I want to share with you from this subject, try God. Try God. Try God. Try God. If you sit next to somebody, just tell them, try God. Maybe you need to tap yourself and just say, try God. Try God. Try God. Try God. As this pivotal scene is playing out in this book of 1 Kings chapter 17, as we know the story of Elijah, God had prophesied that there would be a famine in the land, so he sends Elijah away. Elijah is fed by ravens. That was a couple of weeks ago. Minister Ed McGrady talked about how Elijah was being fed by the ravens, by the brook. Well, the brook dried up. And now God moves Elijah from one place to another. He moves him to the area of Zarephath. And there in that city of Zarephath, there was a widow. As Elijah is there in the city, he comes across this widow and he asks her first for a cup of water. He just says, can you please bring me something to drink? Now, I need you to know historically in those times, the prophet or the people had a responsibility just to look after the prophet, because the prophet, based upon the history between God and the people, the prophet represented God to the people. And so therefore it was always the responsibility of the people to look after the prophet. All right. And so Elijah just simply asked the woman, can you bring me something to drink? As she's going to get something to drink, he then asked her, can you bring me a piece of bread as well? Can you bring me just a little something to nibble on? Bring me something to drink. Bring me something to nibble on. And that's where she basically gives her assessment of what she has and also how she expects this thing to end. I feel like shouting on a Wednesday evening, but I'm gonna hold it back. She gives Elijah an assessment of what she has, but then she also predicts what's going to happen. Based upon what this woman sees, based upon what she sees with her natural eyes And what she is assuming between her assessment and her assumption, she gives it to Elijah. She says, hey, listen, I don't have bread in my house. As a matter of fact, I'm gathering these sticks so that I could go home, make a little fire, combine this flour and olive oil, make a little something to eat, and then my son and I will die. This woman, because there was a famine, had already predicted, based upon her assessment, good God Almighty, based upon what she sees, based upon what she has, she already believes how she knows this thing is going to end. The assumption is we're going to eat this last meal and we're going to die. But Elijah says, listen, go ahead and do what you were going to do. Guys, go ahead and do what you were planning on doing. But before you eat this meal, before you eat your last supper, break me off a piece and feed me. And God declares through this prophet saying to her, God says, and if you do this, if you, yeah, try God, you won't ever run out of flour or oil until the famine is over, until the rain comes and the crops begin to grow. And so this woman, who has already assessed her situation and made an assumption of how it was going to end, she tried God. I wanted to share this word with you tonight on a Wednesday evening because there are many of us who are looking at what it is we have to deal with, what we're facing, and we've already made the assessment. I don't think God has a problem with us making the assessment. But don't allow your assessment to lead to assumption. I could drop the mic if I had a microphone right now. Never allow your assessment to lead you to assume. Because when you begin to assume, that means you have excluded God. And I'm here tonight to suggest to you to try God. Before your assessment leads you to that assumption, place God in the middle of that assessment and see if God won't make a way out of no way. I'm sharing this tonight with someone because you've assessed your situation. You've assessed your family's needs. You have assessed your finances. You have assessed your health. You have assessed your job possibilities or lack thereof. You've assessed, and the assessment is real. That's what I had. The widow shares with Elijah her assessment. She says, here's what I have. I got a little bit of gold medal flour, and I got a little bit of Crisco left. I'm going to combine the two over this heat. We're going to eat, and then we're going to die. Her assessment was true. All she had was a little flour, and all she had was a little cooking oil, but her assumption was wrong. Her assumption was wrong because she just figured that when all of this runs out, there will be nothing left. But Elijah encourages her. Elijah's encouraging us to try God. Now, there are many who confuse this, and they look at this text as if Elijah is the one that's being fed, and he is. But this actually is a test of faith. This is showing where you're at. This is showing the faith that you have. And if you go back and you really analyze this chapter 17 of 1 Kings, you'll see where she says to Elijah, your God. She's a foreigner. She hasn't necessarily subscribed to the God of Elijah, the God of Israel, but she's heard about God. She's known the miracles that God has performed for Israel. And so she says, your God. But what Elijah tells her is, this is what my God, good God, this is what my God will do for you. Listen, if you live a life of faith, if you try God, if you put God to the test, God will meet your needs. And you will not, whatever assumptions you had made, those assumptions will not happen. And there are some of you watching this tonight, you can agree based upon the past that you've had some assessments of your situations and you made the assumption of how it's going to turn out. But when you included God in that equation, God turned that thing around. I know it's a Wednesday. It's not a Sunday morning. But can somebody give God a hand of praise? Because the assumption that you made did not happen. Here's the assumption that I'm making. It's not an assumption. I'm making a prediction. I'm stating a fact right now that when you include God in your situation, when you include God in whatever assessment that you are making, you are now activating the power of God to be released in your life and in that situation. And it goes even further. And I didn't read this in the rest of the book, but in the rest of this chapter, the woman and Elijah and her son continue to eat. Here it is. But then eventually her son does die. And Elijah is there. And she petitions Elijah. She said, why have us live any longer when this was going to happen? And the scripture says that Elijah took the boy to his room, stretched the boy out. Elijah laid over the boy, talked to God as he prayed over that child over three times. And on the third time, this young boy got up. What am I here to say tonight? I'm here to tell you that when you try God the first time, you got to continue to include God in the question from in the equation from here on out. Don't just try God one time and put God back on the mantle. No, you need God to walk with you. You need God to talk with you. In every facet of your life, you need to try God. You need to bring God in. Make God a living, breathable part of every facet of your life, and you will truly live a blessed life. I thank God today. I thank God for this word. I thank God for you. And I want to encourage you to try God. I know it looks empty. I know you seem as though it's running on empty and you about to lose it all. I know you're ready to throw in the towel. However, try God. I know you've talked to other folk, and I know you've made a critical assessment about what you're facing. And I know you've already begun to make an assumption, but don't allow that assumption to take place. Don't give that assumption any more energy. Don't feed in any more of your time or your thoughts. Try God, and God will turn that thing around. Is there anybody here that can just wave a hand or clap a hand and tell God, thank you for turning this thing around? My brothers and sisters, on this Wednesday evening, my word to you is to try God. Make your assessment. Count up the cost. Look at what you got. Yeah, because God wants you to see what you have. God wants you to see how little it may be, how small it appears to be. But then try God and take an assessment afterwards. And I know it is going to lead you into a world of praise and thanksgiving, because what God has done in your life. God bless you, my brothers and sisters. I pray that you've been encouraged. You got to try God. Some of you are racking your brains and having sleepless nights over the foolishness of the world. You can't control that. Listen, you have what you have. Take your assessment, but don't make that assumption. Try God and watch God turn it around. God bless you. I look forward to having you join us tomorrow evening at 7:30. Tomorrow night, we're going to discuss Naaman and how he had to try God and follow the instructions of the man of God. But until then, my brothers and sisters, be blessed. Have a wonderful Wednesday evening, and don't forget to try God. We'll see you soon.